I'll be discussing adherence factors and adherence issues in the Indian population of diabetics. Unfortunately, only about 25 to 30% of diabetics are able to reach their target goals of therapy. Why is this so? Number one, patients are often in a state of disbelief. The acceptance is not there that there is a disease which needs regular treatment. Secondly, the family support may not be there. Often people do tend to neglect people in families, especially in dysfunctional families. Patients get lost to follow up, they do not report back to doctors on time. Naturally, whatever modifications of treatment are required are often not done. Lack of motivation is there in such patients, and they think that if they are having diabetes, they are in a separate category and they tend to look down upon themselves. Also, as the disease progresses, the number of drugs or insulinization may be added to therapy and the complexities increase, it often leads to some amount of non-adherence to therapy without letting the doctor know. So what does it lead to? Obviously, if the treatment is not adequate or complete, there is increased morbidity and mortality, and the treatment cost also goes up. Cost of treatment in any case is a big factor in the adherence issues in our country, because most people pay out of their pocket for therapy. So the onus is on the doctor also, in collaboration with the patient, to devise a methodology of treatment which can be suitably adhered to by the patient. Also, there are perceptive defects in our patients which is found. You will often find or hear of a concept of weak and strong medicines. This is something which needs to be totally counseled, to be counseled properly by the doctor to the patient. Also, the family support has to be good, and regular patient education programs need to be conducted so that the patients understand the value of therapy and how it is going to impact their life in the future, to lead a life which is free of complications with a good quality of life. Today I'll be talking about the categories of diabetes. Diabetes can be broadly be categorized into type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, genetic diabetes, gestational diabetes, and diabetes associated with other endocrinological disorders. Diabetes is a state of high blood sugar called hyperglycemia, which is characterized by absolute or relative insulin deficiency and a variable degree of insulin resistance. Type 1 diabetes is characterized by absolute insulin deficiency. Type 2 diabetes by a relative insulin deficiency with insulin resistance of a variable degree. Genetic diabetes, also called MODY, is something which is identified in families and characterized by particular gene defects. Gestational diabetes is found in women who develop a certain degree of hyperglycemia during pregnancy. And lastly, diabetes associated with other endocrinopathies like Cushing syndrome or thyroid disorders are present at the same time and which require treatment simultaneously. Often it is asked whether diabetes runs in families, that is, if the parents have had diabetes, then would it be there in the siblings or the progeny also? The classical example is that of identical twins, where one twin may develop type 1 diabetes but the other may not, because genes form the basis whereas environment pulls the trigger. Likewise, in type 2 diabetes, if one takes proper adequate care of his environmental factors like obesity control, exercise, diet regulation, often where one sibling may develop diabetes whereas the other may not. So, broadly speaking, these are the categories of diabetes. Today, I will be discussing about the risk factors for development of type 2 diabetes in women. Often, it is possible to screen women who might be having one or more risk factors and counseled about the development of type 2 diabetes. Now, who are such women? Number 1. Overweight ladies. Number 2. Ladies who hardly indulge in any form of physical activity, that means grossly inactive. Third, ladies with a strong family history of type 2 diabetes, running in either one parent or both parents. Women who suffer from a status of what is known as pre-diabetes, by which we mean impaired fasting glucose, which is referred to as an increased fasting sugar, or impaired glucose tolerance, which is referred to an altered glucose tolerance status. Also, ladies who may have suffered from gestational diabetes during pregnancy, or ladies who are suffering from polycystic ovarian disease, or ladies who may have delivered a child more than 4 kg birth weight, or ladies having other risk factors like hypertension and dyslipidemia, which is referred to as altered lipid profile. So when you have a patient who are having one or more of these risk factors, it is prudent to counsel the patients and tell them that they may be developing diabetes in the near future if they do not take care of their risk factors properly.